Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Elders Panel. We've got a great group of people to talk with you today. I'm going to introduce them one by one, and I'll ask you to put your questions in the Q&A box, and we will look at those at the end after everybody has spoken. Our first speaker is Kyler Brodus. Kyler Brodus is known worldwide for his work in the LGBT and trans movements. He's a Black man of trans experience who has been a longtime pioneering activist as an attorney, a public speaker, an author, a lobbyist, and a professor. So Brodus has advocated for trans plus and LGB clients in the courts, before the US legislatures, the US Civil Rights Commission, and the US Congress for decades. He's the founder of the Trans People of Color Coalition, which is the only national organization in the U.S. dedicated to the civil rights of all transgender people of color. He's also on the board of the National Black Justice Coalition, where for 3 years he was the board chair, and he currently serves on the Freedom for All Americans board. He was awarded a proclamation by the city's attorney's office of Los Angeles, and his more than 30 years of contributions to the movement have been recognized with several prestigious awards. And he has been featured in various documentaries and media as he continues to fight for social justice. So I turn it over to Kyler Brodus.
Thank you, Aaron. I'm glad to be here today and to share in this historic moment. I've always wanted to be in Canada and do this. Now I get to do it remotely. I have been in Canada though. I always like to open up with something that's funny. And now I get to see what late night show hosts call a joke falling. But seriously, I've spent a lot of time thinking about trans elders and how and where we are within the movement, and where I fit in, which has become an interesting question all the time of late, because I've done work in every segment of the community as I've looked at it through the years and not pocketed myself. But the last few years, I have made an effort to do work within the people of color or BIPOC community, and the Black, Indigenous, and people of color communities. And I think it's important because they are more marginalized communities. And why I chose that is because obviously my own identity tracks with that group of people. And I can relate greatly because of how my experiences in society, and it just was an easy fit to walk into after working so many years into the LGBTQ plus community and the trans community, which have kind of been conflated, and seeing elders that had been on the front lines, kind of left behind, if you will, and not taken care of, including myself, because we were people that couldn't get jobs. So if we couldn't get jobs when we were younger, certainly jobs were not going to be available when we get older. They aren't for any group of people. So that doesn't exempt transgender people, which still are one of the most discriminated against groups of people in most parts of the world. So I began to hear, as I travel, I always hear themes come at me. And then I had started working on this board called Mary's House for older adults, pardon me. But I had not picked up the older adults in my head because I was still in my 40s when I joined that board. And I thought, why am I on this board? And I'm on many other boards. But things sort of connected when health issues started plaguing me early on. And then I began to think about what would happen to many elders. And as I saw the cases started coming down when people were even married and families came in and tore different couples apart and their unions apart and their years of living together apart, but also how would you be treated if you're left alone in a facility and they don't know how to treat you as a transgender patient? So just the many thoughts that ran through my head of the many things that I've done, and now not necessarily shifting gears from the work that I still do, which is important also, which is still fighting for the daily rights of, you know, employment. And can we walk the streets without being discriminated against or killed? But also, when we live through those things, as transgender now people are living through and being out about, invisible about, do we have places to rest our head that are safe and that we can go to and that our rights are protected as well? So looking towards that, and that's what I feel I have been engaged in more so in addition to the regular, what I call the not bread and butter issues, but the mainstay of just fighting for general civil rights that we deserve and that we had to sustain the last 4 years of an administration that was definitely not good on our issues. We're still fighting some of those battles in the United States on state issues that are lingering. And even though we will still be fighting some of those on the federal level that we didn't expect post this last administration. So at any rate, all those thoughts to come together to say, we've still got a lot of work to do. We've done a lot of work. We have a good federal administration in the United States at this time for us that has helped to bring back rights that were taken away via executive order that we hope we get through Congress. And as folks know, the Equality Act made it through the House that we hope that we can get through the Senate. And it may have made it through the Senate. My Bell's palsy memory may have lapsed on that. But I think we'll see more rights to come for all LGBTQ Americans and trans Americans with resistance. But I think it's time, because once society has changed, the greater amount of people have changed in favor of these rights. It will change, but we do have to look at what is happening with elders, and not much work has been done, and much is to be done in that area. So I think I've spoken near my time, and I will look forward to questions later in the presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Kyler. And we'll come back, I'm sure, with questions and more discussion a little bit later on. The next speaker is Joanna Clark. I've known Joanna for a long time. Joanna is an 81-year-old person who has struggled through the 1940s and the 1950s and the 1960s with her gender identity. And in 1957, she joined the U.S. Navy and served 14 years, including deployments to Okinawa, the Philippines, and Vietnam. Joanna served in the Naval Reserve from 1969 to 1974, when the Navy abruptly discharged her following her acceptance into the Stanford gender program. She underwent surgery in 1975 and 3 months later was invited to join the Army Reserve. Joanna raised her gender identity with the recruiter and was told that if she could pass the physical examination, she would be accepted. So she did, and she was sworn in as a sergeant first class, becoming the first person to serve as both a male and a female in the U.S. military. But later, her enlistment was voided. A four-year court battle followed that, and in the end, she received an honorable discharge with credit for time served and a monetary settlement. Joanna returned to school after that and met Jude Patton, who is also on the panel today. And Jude nudged her to become an activist. She attended a support group one evening with Jude, where the participants were complaining that they couldn't get jobs because they couldn't change their birth certificates because of a law that didn't allow that. And she flippantly said, well, change the law. And the next morning, Joanna set out to do that. And by January 1st, 1978, it was done. Joanna continued as a trans activist until 1988, when she made vows as a religious sister and became Sister Mary Elizabeth. That's the point where I met you, Joanna. You were Sister Mary Elizabeth then. She then became an AIDS activist, founding the AIDS Education Global Information System, AGIS, which became the largest free access HIV/AIDS information library on the planet. AGIS lost its funding in 2014 and closed in 2015. And today, Joanna Clark is an environmentalist. I'm very pleased, Joanna, that you could join us, and I look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Well, thank you for the introduction. Now I don't know what I'm going to say. You told my story. Everything went well in the military, I should say. And when I found out that I shouldn't have been there in the Army, I showed them the regulations and they said, don't worry about it. And what caused the problem was they nominated me for warrant officer. And when the paperwork got to Washington, the gates of hell opened up. And the next thing I knew, my enlistment was voided. But interestingly, they sent me over to the Naval Hospital for a physical. And the doctor, Captain Jose Smith, was doing my pelvic exam. And he says, this is too important. Can you come back tomorrow? And I says, certainly. And so when I came back the next day, he had me see the head of each department, who was a Navy captain and board certified in their specialty, and told me not to tell them unless they asked me outright. And so only one person asked me outright, and that was the gynecologist. And he was complaining that any ensign could have been doing this physical, and he didn't understand why he had to do it. So anyways, they wrote it up that I was disqualified only on the basis of AR 40-501, paragraph 213S, but qualified physically and psychologically to perform the duties of her rank and position and recommended full retention. And with that, the Army voided my enlistment. And it took 41 years before President Obama and Ash Carter, the Secretary of the Army, or Secretary of Defense at that time, overturned the regulation and opened the door so that transgendered could serve. Then along came our psychopathic president, Donald Trump. And the first thing he did is he threw out the regulation and said that we can't serve anymore. And they started discharging some of us that were still in. Fortunately, he didn't get reelected, and the regulation was put back in place, allowing us to serve. It made me think about Christine Jorgensen. Jude had introduced me to Christine. And the day that I met her, I was in uniform. And as we walked into her living room, she turned and asked me, do they know? And I says, some do, not all. And she says, your day will come. And then she talked about progress. the fact that we take three steps forward, and then we take two back. Well, I would say with Trump, we took a giant leap back. But with the President Biden coming into office and that, we've pretty much regained most of our rights that we lost, but we still got a few to go. And I'm just amazed today because of the fact that I'm here, and what you're doing here didn't exist in 1970 or 60 or 50. You were pretty much on your own. And when you got to the gender programs like Stanford, you got evaluated and then said, okay, go out and live in the role for a year and we'll see if how you do. And that was about it. Very, very little support. And that's basically by the time I met Jude, and which was just before I went into the Army. So we've come a long ways. We've got a lot of work to do yet, but I did find out that in the process that if we need to change the law, we can do it. It just takes a little bit of effort on our part and not to be fearful about them finding out who we are. We write our letters to Congress. We go knock on doors. We tell them that we need this law through. Like, for example, H.R. 1 that we're trying to get through. It passed the House this time, but it was killed in the Senate by the Republicans. It's not over. The battle will continue. And the more we speak out, the more progress we'll make towards getting all those regulations that have been barriers to our happiness overturned. So today, as Aaron said, I'm an environmentalist. I've been out of the community, so to speak, for 25 years while I was working with Aegis and growing. Yet we had 6 employees at our peak. We served an average of 18 million people a year that use the service. We've got letters of appreciation from senators. And right now, if you've been watching TV, you see Tony Fauci on. And Tony was one of our big fans. And when we had to close down, we gave the database to NIH. And they've slowly been incorporating it into the National Library of Medicine's database. And now I'm strictly working on environmentalism, trying to save the planet so we'll have a place to enjoy life. And our grandchildren will have a place to enjoy life on down the road. So that's about it, Aaron, unless you got any questions.
I have lots of questions. I'm going to let some other people speak, and then we're going to come back around to questions. Next speaker is Susan Gapka. Susan Gapka is a dedicated campaigner for social justice. She has worked for affordable housing, homelessness, mental health, harm reduction, and lesbian, gay, bisexual, and trans issues for almost 20 years. As founder and chair of the Trans Lobby Group, Susan helped to persuade the province of Ontario to fund sex reassignment surgery and to change the Vital Statistics Act so that trans people can change their legal identities. She's also worked on the campaign to amend the Ontario Human Rights Code to include gender identity and gender expression. Susan has served on the Toronto Local Advisory Committee, on a housing panel for Mental Health Commission of Canada, on the boards of Pride Toronto, which hosted World Pride 2014 and Fierté Canada, the board of Fierté Canada, and Susan has been an education and training facilitator at the 519 Community Center in Toronto since 2015. She has served in numerous elected positions in the Canadian Union of Public Employees as well. Susan Gapka is a proud recipient of the Center for Addictions and Mental Health, which is also known as CAMH, Courage to Come Back Award, which she won in 1999, the City of Toronto Pride Award in 2004, a Canada 150 Different Makers in Difference Makers in Mental Health Award in 2017, and she holds a key to the city of Toronto, which was awarded to her in 2018. So, Susan, your turn.
Thank you, Dr. Aaron DeVore, for inviting me today. I'm just going to tinker with technology here. And so my name is Susan Gapka. My pronouns are she, her, elle français, s'il vous plaît. And it was about a year ago I was packing to go to Victoria to see you all in person. And welcome everyone who's come here today. So that's given me an extra year to embrace this trans elder role, although it sounds a lot like transgender role. I'm so blessed to have the gift of life. When I was a youngster, a teenager in Trenton, Ontario, afraid of my own shadow, guilty and shameful about my suppressed gender identity, I ran away from home and ended up on the streets of Toronto, institutionalized, traumatized, and criminalized. So lucky to have the gift of life. I came out about 20 years ago and realizing that this desire to live as a woman, to become Susan, was not a passing phase. I first met Aaron DeVore at National Association of Women, in the Law. I was a bit starstruck. Micheline Montreuil was there. I was on a panel with them. Barbara Finley was scheduled to be there, and so many others. A young Kyle Scanlon. I was pretty fresh, but as Aaron said yesterday when we touched base, it was kind of like I was on fire. Well, I've lost a bit of my flame since then, but it really felt important to me at that time that I create, help steer a better path for people who had the same challenges around their gender identity. Around 2000, I got a group of people together. We called ourselves the Health Alternate Advocacy Group called HAG. That's how, I guess, suppressed we were, that we didn't want trans in the wording around political advocacy. I had come out while going to George Brown College and working at City Hall in Councillor Olivia Chow's office. At City of Toronto, they have a Pride, a Human Rights Day in December, I think December 6th or early in December every year. And I met a member of Provincial Council, an out gay politician named George Smitherman, and it came to my attention that the provincial government had recently cut funding for what was called at the time sex reassignment surgery. So I got a group of people together. We started meeting informally. We had our first political meeting with Gerard Kennedy in 2001, and I have those minutes somewhere, and I want to donate them to the archives when we can actually meet in person. When I came out at school and in my work at City Hall, I haven't been the same since, and neither has the city, I don't think. But I had to call all these other people that I had been doing advocacy with. One of them was Gerard Kennedy. He was a Liberal member of provincial parliament in Parkdale High Park, where I lived at the time. And I called Gerard and I said, I'm changing my name to Susan. I'm going to live as a woman. And he said to me, I hope that you still come and work for us. So what happened? So that was sort of my political beginnings in some regard. Very empowering, a lot of bumps on the road, but hey, gift of life, I'm still here. What we did with our group is we ended up joining the Rainbow Health Network, and we called ourselves the Trans Health Lobby Group because it was a health network built on access denied from Vivian Namaste, and that chapter is in her Invisible, award-winning Invisible Lives book. And that was prior to Martine Stonehouse, who I want to just acknowledge in the audience, came to us and said she wanted to advocacy around the case because the government had relisted surgery. She was one of the litigants in a case going forward. So we became kind of the advocacy group on that. But you know, if we needed to do everything on trans rights, we would have a list of 100 things we need tomorrow. So we focused on three priorities. The first one was to fund sex reassignment surgery. That was called it back then. It's now called transition-related surgeries. It's got different terms. This is you know, an urban, central Toronto sort of Canadian sort of context that I'm speaking from. Ontario had delisted it in the surgery in 1998, and just short of 10 years, it was relisted through our efforts, through the commission, through the Human Rights Tribunal, and advocacy on June 3rd, 2008. That was a great success. We November 28th, 2007, we actually lost that human rights case and it was on appeal. So what we decided to do was amend the Ontario Human Rights Code to include gender identity. And for the first three or four renditions of that document, Sherry DeNovo was our NDP member of provincial parliament. First three, maybe four renditions of that, those drafts, which I helped draft, did not include gender expression. We were at a community forum at a community church, which actually funded our previous project that I talked about in the last session. Someone from the audience said, add gender expression, and Sherry shrugged and said, okay. And that's the version that actually got adopted. So we were one of the first in the country, I think, to have gender expression added on June 13th, 2012. And the other priority we really wanted to focus on was the Vital Statistics Act. And I was at a session earlier around, that's become probably one of the, I think that's been, it's, let me just go back to the situation in Ontario, and I think across the country, that you need, require transsexual surgery and a whole bunch of other archaic things like not being married, because if you were married, you would become the same sex, and that couldn't happen, but that was struck down as well. But we supported, got the lawyer, and for the person who brought the human rights case forward, they were successful, and it was struck down. The government had that you need require transsexual surgery to be able to change your record of birth on your birth certificate, which is governed by the Vital Statistics Act. And so the government had 6 months to revise that, and our group worked with the ministry and the government on changing that, and that was October 8th, 2012. I remember that because I don't tell anyone. My birthday is the day after, so that's a date I'll always remember. I remember all of these dates. Another thing we did, I was on the board of EGAL Canada, learned a lot through marriage equality and same-sex marriage, but we actually introduced to the Canadian Human Rights Act the first of, I think, four, maybe five renditions to amend the act to include gender identity and gender expression. It was adopted, I think, in 2017 under what is now known as the Liberal Bill C-16, and we started like at Bill 400, 289, 270, 276, and then 16. So you can see as the numbers go, that's the order that they get numbered on priority. These three pillars, human rights protection, access to health care, and being able to change your identity documents, were the three foundational pillars for social inclusion into Ontario and Canadian society. How did we accomplish this? Wanted to have political agency for trans people. We were known back then as transsexual and transgender people, transvestites in Quebec, as part of a great deal of contention, identity politics, flame wars online about that. But I guess this is where I mention the Trans Health Project that Rupert Raj, a previous trans elder, we coined the word trans people to try to come up. We're persons, we're transitioning, and it's published in the Trans Health Project with Ontario Public Health Association in 2003. I haven't found any earlier documents, but there's a lot of young researchers out there who I hope you will take this to find out when that first appears in the literature. What we did was a lot of public education. We wanted to educate the publics, the politicians, and the media about the everyday lives and struggle of trans people. So our group would meet with a lot of politicians, did a lot of media interviews. In some ways, I came as a spokesperson for the group. And not only me, but I mean, it takes a village to change the world. It took a lot of us, but on some ways, I gained a profile, and I enjoyed it. After living my life, it had its bumps. I've been called all sorts of things in the media. We've come a long ways, and the hope to the younger people in the audience is that there's been so much dramatic change in the last 10 or 20 years. Just imagine, there's going to be some pushbacks, but just imagine what is possible. The next generation, I don't know what sex or gender is going to look like in a world without it, but it's a beautiful thing to dream about. And I guess the third goal was really just to achieve our legislative goals, which I'm very proud to have played a historical role in. The bill that our progress around 2012 actually was a minority government. So we worked with all three elected parties, the Liberals with Yasser Naqvi, who became the Attorney General, Progressive Conservatives with Christine Elliott, who co-signed the bill, who is now the Minister of Health during a pandemic in Ontario right now. She'd been running for leadership positions, and this was just the moment where if you're running for leadership, you can't actually do all of this. You're in a different position with your party trying to get elected. And of course, the feisty, the fabulous Sherry DeNovo with the NDP. Just checking, I've got 10 minutes on my time here, so that's great. I might have started a few minutes late. But we also had the opportunity with the trans lobby group to bring in ban conversion therapy in a minority parliament. There's another person out there, Vincent Bolt from TG Inner Selves from Sudbury, who actually is who I didn't know till later when Sherry talked about it, was a motivating factor in banning conversion therapy. We did that without amending the criminal code. That's the bill in the federal parliament. And my view, and it's a very strong view, it's not shared by some people, but let's not use the criminal code, which has made our lives illegal and criminalized us as LGBT or trans people. I'm not of the view that there's other ways to ban conversion therapy without using the criminal code. We also were able to amend the trans inmate policy with the Yasser Naqvi in the minority parliament, and that was a regulation, and it's one of the strongest ones. Unfortunately, that hasn't been implemented the way the legislation regulation reads, that wardens have jurisdiction and employees are not following the code. According to me, I've got about 3 or 4 minutes left. I want to tell you a little story about C-389. Ten years ago, it was a Sunday. We got news at third reading. The bill had never passed the House. That for the trans rights legislation had never passed the House. So missing the Super Bowl, driving to Ottawa in a storm, I'm like, oh my God, the Super Bowl is really important. And Monday, we check into the motel, we go to the Hill, Parliament Hill, which is our federal jurisdiction, I'm getting a little emotional telling this story. Sorry about the time. I'm almost there. Almost there, Michael. So there's the reading, but no vote. We get in the van, go to Montreal. I check into the surgical clinic there. There's a surgical clinic. I've never publicly stated I had my surgery 10 years ago. In a person who's so public, I felt I needed some personal boundaries. And this is something I kept very, very low key. So the next day I had my surgery, the day after the vote happens, I'm listening to it on the radio in the surgical unit or in the recovery unit. And I start crying when the bill passes. I actually did an interview from there, from my bedside. And I think that's really kind of awesome. And then I'm getting interviews when there was opposition to the legislation. I did radio interviews from my bedside, but when they wanted someone to come into the studio, I said, well, we have people in Toronto that can help you out. Just on a message of hope, just in closing, you can see I live in the world of cup half full, that my life has been hard. Trans peoples, and you don't have to be trans to struggle in society nowadays, but I live in the world of hope. I get to be a leader for an entire younger generation of trans families, children, parents, etc. And it makes me be a better person if I live in that land of cup half full and the land of hope. No more angry Susan anymore. Let's just, I just want to close on like the message of hope for everyone. Thank you, Michael, for giving me an extra minute, and I'll turn it over to Aaron to introduce the next panelist. Hope that was appropriate.
Susan, that was great. Thank you very much. And thank you for keeping such a good eye on the time. But much more importantly, thank you for all the work you've done and the great stories that you just gave us. Our next speaker is Jude Patton. And Jude and I also go back a long way. Jude is an avid lifelong student, very much an avid collector of LGBT history, ephemera, and books, conservation and environmental advocate, and animal welfare and social justice advocate. He served on the founding board of directors of what's now known as WPATH, the World Professional Association for Transgender Health, then called the Harry Benjamin International Gender Dysphoria Association. And so the founding board from 1979 to 1985, and then again on the board from 1999 to 2001, and he is currently a member of the WPATH, the World Professional Association, the US PATH, and the Canadian Professional Association for Transgender Health. He was the treasurer of FTM International from 1997 to 2000, and was on the board for the Ingersoll Gender Center in Seattle from 1997 to 2004. Jude now serves on the board of Servant Hearts, which sponsors the Wisdom Circle Support Group for Elder LGBTQI2S people, and on the board of the Gay and Lesbian Medical Association. He is a SAGE Educational Ambassador, a member of the Transgender Aging Network, and the Diversity and Inclusion Committee of the American Institute of Aging. Jude is employed as a psychiatric physician's assistant at Hope Collective, which is a community mental health agency in Sacramento, California, serving homeless, chronically mentally ill, and dual diagnosis clients. He also maintains a private practice as a consultant in end-of-life care for LGBTQI2S clients and their families and allies. I'll turn it over to you, Jude.
Well, like Joanna, you've told I. From my introduction, my story, and much of the work that I value has already been said, but I can give you some more details about this, especially about the early years and the work for many FTM people. Susan mentioned Rupert Raj's name, and Rupert and I were in touch in the very early years of all this since the 1970s, and really actually started being involved in the work itself in 1970-1971, although he was and remains much younger than I when he started. And actually, he was the only person I met who was an FTM person involved in networking with others openly and living openly until about 1977, when I was in touch with Mario Martino, who wrote the book Emergence, which is the first, that wasn't the first book or memoir of a female to male person, but it was contemporary to me. It was the first one I read. I was very lucky to get involved with the early years of the Harry Benjamin group. That came about because my surgeon, Donald Laub, at Stanford University, was open to me attending some early meetings even before that group became Harry Benjamin and then later WPATH. He was so concerned that the community didn't really have a voice at the time. So in 1979, at a conference, one of the early conferences for HBGDA, and as you said, the founding board was 79, but in one of the meetings, he asked for a vote to have a community advocate elected to join their board, and that ended up being me. Well, I can't say that I was so special. I was really the only trans guy that was open and out at the time. And so I served in that capacity to sort of be a liaison between what the community wanted the board to hear and the group to hear, the membership to hear, but also take what they were doing back to the community and see if there could be a collaboration of that. In the beginning, I, like many others, and I'm pretty sure this goes for a whole lot of people who are advocates and activists now and earlier, is we didn't start out with that intent, that we really started out simply, for instance, much of the information that is so available today on the internet was not available at all. I could even go to the stacks in the libraries of the medical schools and not find very much. And what I found was, I don't want to say primitive, but certainly early research that focused on us as being, as Susan said, mentally ill and so on and so forth with that identity, even up until the present time in some places. A couple of things happened within a few years. One was that just after I had completed my own round of surgeries at Stanford, a friend of mine was asked to go speak at a sociology class at Cal State Long Beach and didn't want to do it, didn't want to be that open about it, and asked me if I would consider taking his place, and I did. And I not only got a good reception, not necessarily me as a person, but the subject matter and the person who was moderating the class at the time. And that college professor introduced me to a whole bunch of his colleagues who were teaching both at Long Beach State and all different colleges around the Southern California area. And within a short time, within those early years, and this was 1973, okay, or 74, I was speaking to over 200 college classes a year and sometimes four in a day, traveling a lot of miles to get there in between. For many years, I was the only FTM person doing that. There were people who joined me on panels, but they were trans women, and sometimes cross-dressers would join me on panels, and we would be, for the most part, well accepted. There were some folks who were not so accepting, and even our own communities in some ways, when they were writing their organizations that evolved that I was joining and being part of the board membership and writing our mission. And they often use words like acceptance and tolerance, which I abhor. And I suggested, why don't we suggest that people celebrate our uniqueness instead of accept our uniqueness or tolerate our uniqueness? The other stuff that I've done through my life has been simply an extension of what I did earlier on an individual basis. Most of my life has not been in political work or in work for LGBTQ agencies like most of the people on this panel. Most of my work has been private and clinical as a therapist, as a counselor, as a physician assistant. Most of my work has in those settings has not, except for my own private practice, as a therapist, my work in medicine has not been done in transgender medical clinics or anything like that, although I've had experience as part of working in a regular clinic with not only hormone therapy, but with a lot of psychotherapy that comes along with that for people as they go through their transition and manage their anxiety and difficulties about transition. The one thing I can say is, repeat, several people have said how lucky they are to have the lives they've had and the experiences they've had, even though all of us have also had some negative ones. My mentors are people who are still very important to me. Many of them have gone on. They're no longer with us. And Joanna mentioned Christine Jorgensen, whom I first heard of when I was 12 years old in 1952. And I was later to meet Christine because she lived only about 15 miles from me in Southern California. I wouldn't say we were close, but we were acquaintances. We did visit each other. We did talk together. At the later part of her life, I was of some help with her with a few things that were personal, which I won't discuss. I was invited to be one of the people attending her memorial services. She made up the list herself of who she wanted to attend. And that was a privilege to hear others talk about Christine in such positive ways. It was like she left some money in her will for a party for her service. And everyone who was there was invited to do a little short eulogy of sorts for her. And along the way, I met people that were fun. People who, through a gay male friend of mine, Bob Duran, who was Mae West's fan club secretary, by the way, at the time, I met a lot of female impersonators. And so I'm a big drag enthusiast. And two of the people that I got to meet who were Bob's friends were Craig Russell, who later made a movie in Canada called Outrageous, and a sequel to that called Too Outrageous. And the other person I met was Charles Pierce. And we had a lot of fun times together with me gathering with gay men who I still feel a great deal of closeness to. Along the way, along with all the other things, and I'll go back a minute. In the early years, there were very little gatherings that, as we know today, FTMI wasn't, especially for trans men, FTMI had not yet come about, and it didn't come about until later with Lou Sullivan and then Jameson Green. And in the early 1970s, I started a group for trans men. We would hold meetings and parties at my home in Santa Ana, California. And later, I developed a newsletter called Renaissance, and then still within a short time, an organization called Renaissance Gender Identity Services, not to be confused with the Renaissance back east. And Joanna Clark joined me in that newsletter and then in the services that we provided. Later, the two of us became known as J2CP. And that stood for, there were two J's. So it was Joanna Clark and Jude Patton, J2CP. And that took over what was then the, what had been the Erickson Educational Foundation, that then went to Paul Walker. And then Paul sort of gave that over to us. And then eventually we gave that over to Dallas Denny. So these things were sort of archived, started, continued. Dallas still today does her work, and I'm hoping she's here today watching this. And the good part for me has been the interaction all of these years with people that I've known so long. In the early years, I met Aaron actually through the Scientific Study of Sexuality group, a professional group initially, and I also had belonged to ASECT. And in my private practice, I focused on not only therapy for trans and LGBTQ people, but as a sex therapist, as generally in sex therapy. And some of my early newsletters in Renaissance reflect that with the things that I talked about in those newsletters. I was so stupid that I didn't archive most of my newsletters. I ran out of them. And when I didn't have any more, I didn't have them reprinted. So some of those are not in archives, nor do I own a copy. Though I do own a lot of archival material from that I've accumulated that will go to the UVic collection. Aaron keeps asking me, Jude, when are you going to get that to me? And I said, Aaron, I'm not dead yet, and I don't want to have to travel 1,200 miles to read my own stuff. What I've done now in my elder years is to become more focused, obviously, on aging. Joanna's 81, as she said. I'll be 81 later this year. We've known each other for, since mid-1970s? And we've remained friends ever since. We have a date every Sunday morning now to Skype, and we keep up on each other's activities, mostly in conservation and environmental issues, which I share that concern with Joanna. My time is spent equally divided in my concern about animal welfare and just general social justice things. What I've taken on in my older time now, since I work only part-time, is to begin to write. And I'm not a writer, so, you know, at all. But I have mostly been doing editing of what will be and is planned to be a series of books about transgender elders over the age of 50. Now, I had to sort of hedge a little bit. Why would you call 50 elder? And initially, that was because I wasn't sure I could get enough people over 65. So, and I realized that elder may be not only age, but experience in the world in terms of how many years you've been involved with transgender issues. So the series is called Transcestors, Navigating LGBTQ Aging, Illness, and End-of-Life Decisions. Two of the first volumes came out last year. We've had a pretty good response, and we've had people who think that this is really something that needs to be talked about. I know that Kyler touched on that earlier, that we don't have enough information. We've had this big revolution the last 15 years or 20 years on which still needs to be taken care of, and that's our transgender youth, children, and families. But remember, we're all growing older, and nobody's talking about what, or very few are talking about, are specifically writing about transgender aging. So that's my personal current mission in life, is to do more of that. And I would invite anyone who's watching this or anyone you know who is over the age of 50 who would like to contribute a story to get in touch with me about that. And we can talk about that at one of the tables later on when we have a discussion. In all of this, I've had my own personal life, as we all do. So juggling all these things with, I have had a family. I was married for 26 and a half years. The last 10 years of my wife's life, she was literally dying slowly. She was on dialysis for 10 years. She was blind for the last 5 years of her life, bedridden. We lived on a small farm. We had very few close neighbors. We were isolated from our friends and family by geographic distance. It took a toll on both of us. I thought I would not ever have another partner in my life. Wasn't seeking a partner, but I'm fortunate, and I want to put this out there for those who lament, perhaps. I am currently partnered with a friend that I've had for 40 years. And it's a delightful experience, and I feel very cared for and very fortunate. I had to make a decision about staying in Washington State to go into my first job in a trans clinical practice with Linda Gromko and make a decision. Do I stay there and do that, or do I go to California to be with my partner? And I made the right choice. Only other thing I'll mention is this will sound funny, I hope. I don't know how many of you remember Canary Khan, who wrote a book called Canary, in, I think it was 1976 or so when I met her. And later she did a couple of articles for Playgirl Advisor, the magazine for women that was like the Playboy for men. And in the 1977 issue, there's an article that she wrote in which I'm featured in photographs with her sitting in my living room at my home. And just to let you know how old that is, Playgirl Advisor no longer is in print and hasn't been for many, many years. And if you ever find a copy of that photo, you probably won't recognize me because I did have hair and I had a full beard, all dark and very different looking. Aging is not for sissies. Aging is something that happens to all of us inside and out, but I remain a child or young adult inside, and I would like to leave everyone with that thought. Thank you.
Jude, that was just brilliant. Thank you so much for sharing so many great stories. Final speaker, Chase Willier. Chase Willier is a Nehiya or Cree two-spirit trans man who was adopted as part of the 60s Scoop and grew up in the Sioux territory of Vernon, BC. He joined the RCMP, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, as the second Indigenous woman in BC in 1979. He was out as a lesbian since 1991, and towards the end of his service, he openly identified as trans, although he didn't transition until after he retired in 2010. After 30 years of service, he finally took some time out to address his PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, something he writes about in the book, The Remedy, Queer and Trans Voices on Health and Healthcare. He is passionate about health and wellness, particularly that of the two-spirit trans community, and his work in Vancouver also extends to the area of justice, safety, and reconciliation, and he found that work to be incredibly satisfying. Chase is now a husband and stay-at-home rad dad to his four-year-old daughter. Chase wants to complete the draft of his memoir later this year, as well as continue his elder in training under the guidance of Nehiya elders Phil and Betty Gladue from his home territory in Treaty 8. Chase, it's yours.
Thanks, Aaron. Fancy Chase Willier Nitsigason Nihio Nia Egwa Nigawi Doreen Spence Bonikis Bonix Egwa Notawe Fred Miles Willier CCC Gapirkanach Taskin. Nia Wipanakak, 60 Scoop, Osinia, East Vancouver, BC. I come from you in the traditional territories, the unceded territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Gnaskotmaten. I thank them for their kindness and generosity. And I've lived here for quite a while. I was in the Seashelt, the Okanagan Nation, Seashelt, and then North Vancouver and Vancouver area. So thank you. I need to acknowledge the other speakers and elders on the panel. So my hands up to you and for sharing this morning. Thank you. And thanks, Aaron and Michael, for all your help and support. Oh, and I got some questions. I was wondering what to speak about this morning, and Aaron sent some questions, and there was a lot in there, and I really had to think about it. So one of them was that, how did 60s Scoop shape my gender? And there was a lot in there. So there's a lot to say and a lot to think about, and there's also a lot of pain, but that's part of our journey. For those that don't know what the 60s Scoop is, I'm just going to cite the Indigenous Foundations arts.ubc.ca 60 Scoop. Just they encapsulate it really nicely. 60 Scoop was coined by Patrick Johnson, author of the 83 report, Native Children in the Child Welfare System. refers to the mass removal of Aboriginal children from their families into the child welfare system. In most cases, without the consent of their families or fans. Further to say that was an alarming amount, disproportionate number of Aboriginal children were apprehended from the 60s onward. And by the 1970s, roughly one third of all children in care were Aboriginal. Approximately 70% of the children apprehended were placed into non-Aboriginal homes, for many of them in which their heritage was denied. So that's part of Canada's assimilation policy, and that's been going on for well over 100 years in the 1800s with the beginning of the legislative piece called the Indian Act, which defines all our lives. It does for me as a status Indian. So that's the beginning. I was not raised in my communities. I was given up for adoption, adopted out. And there is a big, long story around that, but suffice to say that I grew up in the Okanagan Nation, or Tsiilks Nation. I grew up in Burnham, B.C., and later in Kelowna, B.C. And from there, I joined the RCMP. As was mentioned, I was the second Indigenous woman. The first was my friend Gloria, who we worked together, who later became the chief of her community up the road in Enderby, BC, and became a lawyer. In my travels in the RCMP, I was very fortunate enough because I worked with my people in various communities, with the West Bank First Nation, where in 1983 I was adopted traditionally, traditional Okanagan adoption by Glenn Douglas, the elder and interpreter for the nation after Tommy Gregoire passed away. I speak to this in a remedy about Glenn, because he had so much of an influence on my life. And I was going down a really rough road. I was really struggling. As an adopted kid, I didn't know my culture. I knew I was closeted as a, you know, queer person, and I was scared to death. I was in the RCMP. I was very scared to death. I was also a woman. And it was a very uncomfortable situation. I carried a lot of shame. When I think about how the 6C scoop shaped my gender, if I could say one word, it would be shame. Something so heavy and so intense that, I carried it like a coat. Nothing could get in, and it took out elders, a lot of people, to hold me up. Glenn was one of them. Always forever grateful to Glenn and Leslie Douglas, to the people of the West Bank First Nation and Lindley family, Roxanne Lindley and her family, who also adopted me into their nation. So people like that, they help you. They know you're struggling, and they pick you up and they support you. And that's our people's way. I came out in the RCMP, I have to preface this and say I was outed in the RCMP in 1990 when I was in Seychelles. I left after 10 years of police in Kelowna and the West Bank First Nation as an Indigenous member, and was transferred to Seychelles, which also has a Shiselet First Nation on the ocean outside of Vancouver, an hour away. I worked there for 2 years and then transferred over to North Vancouver, Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh Nation, and worked for them for a while. I preface it again, I was outed. It wasn't really my choice, but I'm glad it happened because, you know, I had a very frank conversation around that with my bosses, and it was nice to feel that freedom. And, you know, by the time I got to Vancouver and started to come out as lesbian and get into the life, it was great. It was a wonderful, liberating place and time in my life to be. So I stayed with Aboriginal Policing Services, which is now Indigenous Policing Services in the RCMP for the province. Got to travel all over and go into First Nations communities, go do ceremonies, work with the elders, work with the communities in various ways, usually in justice and policing issues. traveled across Canada in various communities. So I was very, very fortunate. Along that way, when I met Glenn, I decided to change my lifestyle and, you know, took a very healthy way of living, you know, and changed a lot of things in my life. So there were some really good, healthy, traditional ways of being and, you know, moving through the world. So by the time I got older, I was living in North Van. I was reunited with my family. I went to my father's funeral and went home to Sucker Creek First Nation for the first time, which is in Treaty 8, Northern Alberta. Later after that, I was reunited with my mother, Treaty 6 in Saddle Lake, Alberta. And it's taken a long time to make full circle. And when I speak around shame, I speak also with my lack of identity, not speaking my language, which I'm learning. My elders, Bill and Betty, asked me to be an elder in training. And to be honest, I was not too crazy about the idea. I don't think that I am elder material in terms of I do not speak my language. You know my Cree songs, know my ceremonies. I wasn't raised in my community. I don't have a relationship to my land, our Cree ways or Mi'kmaq ways. And I was raised in Okanagan Nation and now live in Vancouver. So I did not feel comfortable with that. But my elders, unfortunately, I couldn't argue or they wouldn't hear the argument. So, but this is part of the journey. This is also shame. And it's something that as I speak around gender and the pain and the awkwardness and the hate that I had towards my body and myself. And when I was younger, I was totally self-destructive. I was like gasoline to fire. Like it was not good, not good at all. And it was just a matter of time. And that's when Glenn came along, and the Creator always gives us these people and teachings and puts the right people in the right place at the right time. So I am very grateful for that. I have there's so much in there. I had a lot of foster brothers and sisters, up to 60 of them in my lifetime. I've seen a lot of our First Nation kids, Indigenous kids, struggle in foster care. Two of my brothers did not live a good life in terms of died too young, struggled with alcohol and drugs, and had a very difficult life. So there's a lot of pain and loss, dislocation to overcome. I acknowledge a lot of the Two-Spirit educators and people out there that are doing tremendous work. Some of them I very much admire. Young James McCokas, for instance, kind of a big fan of his, and so many that are doing great work that have had the opportunity to live in their community and grow up with their relatives. So I'm very fortunate. My family has been very accepting to me when I went home and all my relatives, and that allows us to grow and to come home not only as a physical place, but as a place in our heart. A place that we come home in our bodies, a place that we find our own reconciliation. And then we come to know that place in a really good way, a respectful way, an honorable way, so that we can kind of take this and move out into the world and do the things that we need to do, including speaking in a good way and treating others with respect. And today, that's a little difficult, having gone on what's gone on the last few years, but if anything COVID's taught me is spent a lot of time meditating. And it's really, really been a really good thing. So I've learned a lot in this last year. But with respect to gender, I very self-destructive. And I'm just, again, so very grateful. The shame that and this is hilarious. I did a lot of counseling in the RCMP around gender, sexuality, sexual orientation, around 60 scoop, and just about everything you could think of, my PTSD included. But they paid for a lot of counseling for so many years. And I've done a lot of things, not just that, but through ceremony, through other modalities of healing, that I was able to overcome a lot. And I'm not saying that I'm totally there yet, because I am not. I still have difficulties. As an elder, not speaking my language is a very hurtful thing. So I'm trying and I'm learning, and that's all I can do. I have to acknowledge that I'm a very humble elder in training. I am not from, you know, living in my community, and it's just something I'm really trying to do and work hard at doing. So yeah, around gender, it's been a journey. I started out, you know, as an Indigenous woman, which was not a great place to be, as you know, in Canada. So there's been a lot of racism, discrimination, gender, two-spirit. I say all the isms and obias, I feel like I've covered them all, you know, in almost all of them, in ways that perhaps was difficult. I make a joke about people hurting sometimes. You're not going to hurt my little brown feelings. Because it's really hard for me to distinguish, what are you discriminating me about? Is it, you know, when I was younger, was it because I was an Indigenous woman? When I was older, is this a gay thing in the police force? Is this a sexism thing in the police force? Is this a two-spirit thing later on in the police force? And later as a retired, you know, is this a trans thing? So I can't distinguish. I just know and feel. But it's a journey. And if I could leave one thing, it's really important that, you know, we try not to. I've struggled with a lot of resentment and hate and other issues and loss and grief in particular, a lot of loss. But I've been taught that you can't dwell there, you can't stay there, you have to let it go and you have to forgive. But that shuts us off from the sunlight of the spirit of the creator, our Gismanto, our kind, compassionate spirit. So if I can offer anything to the young people, is that don't shut yourself off from the sunlight of the spirit, because the power and the empowerment is there. So open your heart and just let it happen. It'll happen, all in a good way. Thank you.
Beautiful, beautiful words. So those are our presentations. We've got quite a few questions that have come in from the audience. But before we go there, I'd like to put a question to the group that picks up on something that Chase raised, and that I have known from many people who have lived through the period of time that elders, our elders, I'll include myself, have lived through. And that's the word shame. And I think that's been a big piece of all of our lives. And I've seen folks nodding. We can see the other panelists, you watching as attendees don't see everybody all at once, but I'm able to see while Chase was speaking, everybody else's faces on the panel, and there's been a lot of nodding. And I wonder if anybody else wants to say a few words on that subject before I go into the Q&A section. And so please unmute. And okay, I've got Jude, Susan, Kyler. I've got three people already went like this, raised their hands. So, and Michael, is everybody visible now? Can we have, yes, good. Okay, Jude, go first.
Well, I'm going to count myself as an exception to the rule about the shame piece, because I've never felt shame. I've been out all my life as who I am to the extent that I can. And have never felt, you know, at some point was advised to go in a closet early on about the trans issues, particularly. And it was advised as a younger person to be in a closet by my gay and lesbian friends. I had the gift of a wonderful mother who taught me that I was valuable and wonderful and so on. And that protected me and has continues to protect me even now to this day. I would often wonder, why are these people thinking about me in this way? There must be something wrong with them that they can't understand what a wonderful person I am. That was a gift of a mother who adopted me when I was a child. And I was not adopted in the same way that Chase was, but I was given up for adoption by my biological mother, which is probably a gift to me for the rest of my life to get the adoptive mother and father I had.
Thank you, Jude. And Jude has told stories on other occasions about how that wonderful mom also took in a lot of other kids who needed that kind of love and care. So what a wonderful gift she gave to you and a lot of people. Susan, then Kyler.
About shame, guilt. Oh, damn near killed me. Yeah, just afraid of my own shadow growing up. Used to stay up at night hearing creaky, like the stairs creaking or that, just like thinking the monsters were out to get me. Lot of unknowns. I just heard the word adoption. I was adopted. Very unclear beginnings about what my childhood was like. Potential of the, you know, post 1950s around. I'm born 1956, so I don't qualify for a vaccine on both ends here in my jurisdiction, which we'll get to it. And I escaped by covering it up, became hyper-masculine. I was daring. I still don't know fear, really, but I do know how precious life is now. My learning is, well, if I get bullied, I will take someone on as well. But like, I also know if I've got like an exit, if I don't need to be boxed in, that I can't get, I need to quickly assess whether they have weapons or not. And or I, so I'll stand up for myself. I'm a fighter, not a flight. Really the shame and the guilt, I'll tell you, and I still have my moments. Just, you know, like we do our work, we do our therapy, whatever routines that we do. I use meditation the last few years. It's given, no one told me. I had no adult supervision as a youngster. And I'm thinking, why didn't people tell me about this? So now I can go around, have some sense of safety and security, some serenity that, my mind, you got to see what's going on in my mind sometimes. And then, you know, being criminalized and guilty and shameful, like you people here, I'm looking at you, you know where we come from and how hard it is. And yet we're blessed to be here. We have privilege and we're very fortunate to be survivors. But that surviving resilience is what helps me get up in the morning and just enjoy the sunshine. I've gone on, but that really opened something up for me. So I appreciate that you've given the opportunity to speak about it.
Thank you, Susan. Kyler.
What I was going to say is I sort of look at it, or I do, it's not sort of like Jude. Although his hair is white and mine is not quite white, there's white in my hair and less hair on my head. For some wear and tear. I've always looked at it as not my problem. What other people think? I had luckily been born to two very strong parents that grew, that lived through many a toil and struggle as Black people. And they weren't called Black people in their day in the United States. If that gives you the flavor of who they were, and I didn't share my story, but in brief, they lived through hard times, and then out comes a kid that's color non-conforming in the day that I was born in the 1960s during the height of the civil rights movement in the United States, at which every African-American or Black household then was a part of, and they taught me to be proud of who I was. So I still carry that with me, and I'm not ashamed of that. But what I was ashamed of is that I wasn't Black enough. And I had to deal with that because of the color of my skin and the internalized racism and slavery that is internalized that we don't like to talk about, and we get uncomfortable in rooms in the United States and talk about when people talk about it. And those are the things that I talk about. And that's where Chase hit me in the heart, because people of color are always looked at as a suspect. And generally, I've known for years that people don't normally peg me, except I've been a trans activist for years. But I look just like my father. I look just like my male cousins, even pre-transition. So I can walk down the street and the first thing I'm pegged at is a Black man. So am I going to be shot? So I have to not wear my hoodie anymore or my ball caps. And so that's an arc of the conversation that I appreciate Chase bringing that I didn't bring in earlier, is the racial component, because we talk about elders. And Jude, you do have to come down, because I was sitting at a place and realized I've outlived the life expectancy of most Black men and trans Black men, which is 52. That's scary. And I almost fell over when I was at just a Black conference and on a panel to talk about Black men and heard the statistics, and I almost fell over. So that's all I wanted to bring, and bring out that color coupled with being trans and age. You know, we add all the intersections of that and the isms that Chase bring out, and that adds to the stressors to our lives and the length or lessening of our lives. And we have to be aware of that as we go through and plan for even elder care, or who we consider elders, and how we look through lenses of transness when we go through life. So thank you.
Thank you, Kyler. Anybody else want to say a word on that? Or I'll go to the questions from the audience now. Okay, I'm going to go to questions from the audience now. We have a question from one of our younger people who wants to know, what do you see as some of the major generational differences between yourselves and younger generations of trans people? And how can we build alliances across trans generations? Who'd like to speak first? Joanna, we haven't heard from you for a few minutes. Would you like to tackle that first?
That's the difficult question for me. I got involved some time back and for a short period of time with an association of transgendered professionals. It was on Facebook. And they were all talking about present day. And I says, well, you know, you can learn from the past and what it was like 30 years ago or 40 years ago. And their reaction to it was, well, it was no different than it is today. And I said, no, it was much different. There were very few support groups. And even in a support group, everybody would go into the room and work out their issues and what have you. But when they left, they all went their separate ways. And the female to males were much closer to each other. But the male to females, on the other hand, they tended to not want to associate outside the room. Fearing that, well, if they're red, I'll be red. And in a middle age, going through the transition and in middle age, 30s and 40s, your chances of getting red the first time are pretty high for a male to female. But how to bring the two groups together, mm-hmm. so that they can appreciate the history of what has transpired and where we're at today and where we've got to get to if we really want to have all of our rights.
Anybody else want to take a crack at that question? Jace.
Thanks, Michael. I'll just keep it brief. Our elders say, you know, we have to know our history. We have to know where we came from before we know who we are, right? Mm-hmm. That all kind of fits together, but it's interesting that I've run across people that don't even know what Stonewall is, or this conversation of what happened as a community in our past. And we have to, that's the first thing we should know, is to know our history, know our elders, know our people, know what happened. If not for making the same teachings and mistakes, things not to do, things to do, things that have already been done, all that work and all that knowledge behind us. So I'll just leave it at that. Thanks.
Okay. Anyone else? In response to that question, Susan.
I really, thank you. I'm still Susan. At first, I was skeptical of intergenerational panels and forums I had been invited to. I think here in Southern Ontario, we used 50, I heard the word 50, is how do you measure age? Like, is it like rotations around the sun? These are all human-made human-made conditions. You know, we all mature at different rates. The time we came out, the experiences we've had, the trauma we're unpacking, the lessons we've learned and unlearned. But as many people are still don't have family, adult support or strong teachers. So it would really mean a lot to me to, as I embrace the trans elder identity, that we've learned a few things growing up. I remember I was pretty resistant and rebellious as a youth, didn't want to listen to adults. But for those people who, you know, there's some lessons in life, and just to know that there's somebody there who's been through it all is really important. So just really like the idea of some opportunities for intergenerational work. The other thing I noticed, the trans elders used to be at the end of the conference, and now we may not make it the whole way. I'm just laughing. And then now you're closing with the youth panel, which I think is a really interesting change, because that's also, you know, our evolution in some ways. I don't know the reasoning behind that, but yeah, it's having it because it is a younger person's world, and I don't get to say that with people in my own age category very often, but yeah, so I think opportunities to connect in that regard, it will be, I think, is really important.
Thank you, Susan. Kyler, did you want to make some comment?
And I'll be brief, because actually I don't believe in repeating what's said. And Chase said what I say. And normally I say that in my classroom. We don't know where we've been unless we, know where we came from. And so how can we go forward without that? And that works in movements. We can't build a movement unless we know or learn from other movements. And that's so true. And movements are intergenerational. And if we don't get that, then we're lost. All movements are intergenerational. We need everybody in the movement. If everybody's not in the movement, we don't have a movement. And so we have to learn how to reach across and touch everybody. Because a little bit of what Joanna said is true, is that what's old is new. And so some of that hasn't changed. It's how we communicate with each other. And we've somehow created this big divide that we think is so big, but really isn't, because, you know, I seem able to bridge that divide and continue to bridge that divide, because when I go into cities where my former students are or wherever, they want me to hang with them. And, you know, and I'm like, I go hang with them. So they see it differently. And I think in the LGBTQ world, we really age people, like we don't want to name people, but we age people. And I find it very interestingly because I live outside the LGBTQ world and my students get angry if I go to a city and don't yell at them or holler at them. Whereas elder or youth LGBT people go, oh, old man, get out of the way, go out of the way, whatever. So anyway, didn't mean to go on that long, but yeah, we have got to stop aging each other and learn within this movement to work with each other, because we play our isms out on each other within the movement, which allow others to play us.
So I'm a conference nut, and I've been going to trans conferences and cross-dressing conferences before that and whatever else before that. And I'm often, especially these days, every day makes an older day, I'm often one of only a very few, if not the only old person there. When I sit on boards, I'm the only old person there. There doesn't mean I get respect for that. It's just the way it is. And so those of us who can stay involved, who can have our face somewhere, who are elder people, who are willing to be talked to, need to be out there a little bit more. The saving grace, I guess, is to have a younger person come up to me at a conference who somehow somebody tells him, oh, that's Jude Patton. He used to do a lot of work or whatever, because nobody knows that anymore. They'll say, oh, Jude, I'm so glad to see you and that you're still alive. It means I can grow old too. And I thought, well, if that's all I serve, is the only purpose I serve, then maybe that's okay.
That's great. Another question for everybody. And I'd like each of you, if you can, to take a couple of minutes on this. What do you think is your most important contribution to the movement for trans plus, or let's say the trans plus life, the life of trans, non-binary, two-spirit, and other gender diverse people? You know, you've had some years to work on this. What do you think is the most important contribution that you've made? And if it's more than one, that's okay.
I think the most important contribution I've made is the one I'm making now, and that is trying to record people's history in book form or some form. And these are folks primarily, although a lot of the people who do, by the necessity of or the being in a book form, using your name, coming out, perhaps contributing a photo or two, means that the folks who aren't there, who don't want to be there, who have contributed their piece to this, will still not be on an oral interview or on a book thing. But that's the biggest thing. I want to keep improving on what I do. I hope I live long enough to get a lot more contributors to these things, people who would never sit down and write a long memoir or a whole book about themselves, but who can write to the point of not only their own life story condensed, but what it is to be an elder person in the world and have the intersection of being trans or, and then whatever other intersections you have to contribute to that, sort of what we've talked about here today. So that's my piece and I'm sticking to it.
Okay, thank you. Who's next? Yeah, Susan, go ahead.
I'm one of the eager ones. I'm letting you moderate, Aaron. I think my work in, which I didn't have time to do, which is a whole other session, in mental health and in housing. I worked with the Mental Health Commission of Canada on the housing component, and it was kind of we've got a long ways to go on housing in Canada. When I came back from Montreal, our mayor, the brother of our premier here, I'm a little bit politically minded, you might have picked up on that, tried to sell off affordable housing, social housing in Toronto. So for the next month, they put me in a taxi. Here I am in recovery, a lot of maintenance around the surgery. The first couple months is pretty intense. They don't tell you about that before. I would get in a taxi, go to City Hall, do a media event, do an interview. I'd come back home in just a few hours, I'd be knocked out, like exhausted because the physical exertion. But the idea that I can do work other than be that, you know, trans surgery leader, is like, there's a lot of stigma around that at the time, less so now, but that, you know, everyone will benefit from public housing, access to mental health. And so I feel very proud of that, in addition to the policy changes I talked about earlier. And I think it was Jude that said it, just by being ourselves, just by being visible as elders, is so thank you. And I just want to, like, I forgot to compliment. This is like privilege to be in your company. Thank you for just sitting in awe of, like, I made it. I made it here, even though it's online. That I get to share this platform with all of you. I just want to honor and recognize and validate all of our experiences.
Thank you, Susan. Got three more speakers. Kyler.
I'll jump right in. You sent this to us and I read it and thought it was ominous to answer. And, you know, I'm going to answer this like I always do. I'm just a little country boy from a dirt road who, that's where I grew up at, that we had to water every summer to keep the dirt out of the house. And why I do the work I do is because there was no role model for me out there. And I said, I don't want anybody to go through what I had to go through. I saw Christine Jurgensen, and that's such a lovely story, Jude, and would love to have met her. I've gotten since to meet Renee Richards you know, through my work. And Caitlin and I have missed each other and, you know, whatever. That was meant to be a joke. You can laugh at that. Jude got that. I'm not into meeting people. But here's what my work has always been about. That if I could be that person somebody had, and I have been, and I know I have been because people tell me, that they don't lose their life because they see me, then that I've served my purpose. And I get those emails, and not just from trans kids, from the kids that I teach that don't have a mother or a father or an auntie or whomever. Then yeah, I'm a little emotional because it's real for those kids that are marginalized, that come from inner cities, that are brown and black or just poor, whatever color they are. I feel like I'm their cheerleader, and my job is to help them find themselves and cheer them on. And I feel like that I'm put here for that purpose on this earth, and that's what I do. And I'm happy to do that job. And I feel like, yes, that's what I do. And I had two strong people that gave me that. So, yes, that's why I'm here. That's what I do. And the young people are our future, but all people are our future. And so I'm done there because I'm very emotional, but that's what I believe. It is. It's about all people, but I happen to also empower my trans people and make the road better for the other people that come.
I don't know. You know, I didn't set out to be an activist by any means. I can blame Jude for that. But I'm glad that he did. I guess I was in the right place at the right time sometimes to open my mouth and make a sarcastic statement. And then I'd have to go around and say, uh-oh, what do I do now? So that got me involved in changing the laws, you might say. But in terms of my biggest contribution, it wasn't with our community. It was basically going off to Missouri and meeting a couple of PWAs in a small town where the only doctor was a circuit rider. They came to town every Wednesday afternoon for 4 hours. in a time that if people knew you were HIV positive, they had no problem burning your house down with you in it. And so my idea came to mind was electronic bulletin board. This was before the internet. And next thing I knew, the government was asking me to go on the internet. They were paying us for putting Aegis there. But I would say that's my biggest contribution. 25 years, working 16 hours a day, 7 days a week, and enjoying every minute of it. And not often meeting the people that we helped, but every so often we would make contact with somebody, and friendships would develop. And I remember the night I was online, just getting ready for bed, and my monitor was up over my bed. And I looked up, and somebody was browsing around trying to find something. And so I broke in and offered to help. And it was Ruth Thomas, the White House reporter. And so we developed a friendship through that, and that was kind of neat. And I was able to walk her over to what she was looking for. But now, as I say, my time is spent mostly on environmentalism. I'm also fighting the issue of racism that has emerged 500 years ago when there's only one race, the human race. And I don't know if anybody noticed me. I was wearing my favorite T-shirt today. We are all Africans. And when I get engaged with a white supremacist out there, I'm just telling them, go do your DNA and see if you qualify to be a white person. Because you're carrying around mitochondrial leave that came from Africa 65,000 to 130,000 years ago. So I spend a lot of time in that area, mainly on Facebook, arguing with some of the white supremacists and posting stuff there. And I love the statement I learned from Jane Elliott. Prejudice is an emotional commitment to ignorance, which I have on one of my T-shirts. And I get quite a few remarks from people when I wear it out in the public. So.
Thank you, Joanna. Thank you. Jace, you told me earlier that you like getting the last word. So I've saved the last word for you, and I'm going to just wrap us up for, 30 seconds when you're done, but please, if you could answer this question as well.
I don't think for me, there's one particular thing. I've never been that way about picking one thing, but, it's so fluid and it moves along like a river, right? And it's work. And when the people or my people ask me to do something or I step up. I step up and I when asked to do the work, to make a contribution, to do things in a good way. As I was younger, it meant, living the good life and in so many ways. So that young people can look or other people can look and have a role model. It's not what I wanted, but that's what I became. So I had to live a life that was, a respectful life. So, yeah, I don't think it is one thing. I think it's a kind of a collection of many, many things. So I'll just leave it at that.
Lots to think about here. A lot of inspiration. I say thank you to a lot of years of dedicated hard work, giving, and making the world a better place.